party started. We haven't seen each other in a while. We had the snow day last week, so you guys get double the weekly prophetic super sign, because I'm keeping my ones from 2 weeks ago too for you. So let's see what's going on in this crazy world. I found it interesting 2 weeks ago when we talked about Gnosticism, that the Times of Israel, literally the next day after I had spoken on that, which is a major Jewish, I don't know what you call it, publication, newspaper, they actually had an article about this new lost gospel depicts a married political activist Rabbi Jesus. Kind of interesting. And yes, they were pushing a book called The Lost Gospel, which once again is just more of the old Gnostic lies that this original Ephesus church fought. But it's just kind of interesting that we know that it's very applicable, and you guys are going to see more and more of this stuff in the news and as we move forward.
Wasn't Kevin Sprenger asking him about the lost books? About you guys understand that, like, if that ever intimidates you, if you ever are curious to know, how do we know if there are lost books of the Bible? God laid out a model in Isaiah. I don't know if you guys remember us talking about that. But Isaiah is 66 chapters. The 40th chapter talks about the voice crying in the wilderness. The 40th book of the Bible, the New Testament, is Matthew, the voice crying in the wilderness. So Isaiah also covers the end, or the beginning of creation to the end. So God gave us a little model in the book of Isaiah. So we know we have the right 66 books. Also, each gospel writer, each epistle writer in the New Testament has an independent vocabulary divisible by 7. So if there's a new gospel, it would have to have a vocabulary that's got its own vocabulary divisible by 7. And if that's not true, then it has to be thrown out, because God works in, you know, in incredible ways. So just a little, you know, we do have the right books. You know, none of that stuff needs to scare you or intimidate you.
And not to mention, if this Gnosticism stuff that we're finishing up with today, if it interests you, we have lots of materials on it to educate you even further. So keep that in mind. Also, some key things happened in Israel the last couple weeks. I don't know if you guys saw this, but a major publishing company called HarperCollins, they actually omitted Israel from the maps of the Mideast schools. And once again, just another, you guys are going to continue to see anti-Semitism or anti-Jewishness rise as we get closer to the end of the age. It's just going to continue to escalate, because remember that Satan really doesn't like the Jews. One of the prerequisites to Jesus coming back to earth is Israel has to call on their Messiah. They have to call for Jesus to come and save them. So one of the ways that Satan is going to try to avoid Jesus' second coming is he's going to try to wipe out the entire Jewish population. So we'll see anti-Semitism like that all over the place. On more of a positive note, this last year, 2014, was a record-breaking year for what's known as Aliyah, which is where ethnic Jews travel back to Israel. And once again, this is actually fulfilling biblical prophecy. God says that he's going to draw the Jewish people back to their homeland. Right now, unfortunately, they're gathered back in unbelief. Most of them haven't embraced Jesus as their Messiah. But right now, as we see Jews continue to go back to Israel as it's the safest place, that's fulfilling biblical prophecy. So that's kind of a cool stat. We also had in the last couple weeks some very interesting earthquakes. There was a 4.9 in Idaho. There was a 5.1 in California. And the big one, Texas, had 10 earthquakes rock North Texas in 25 hours. So once again, just a cute little sign of Jesus' return. We see continued earthquakes. The one in California is long overdue, and even secular seismologists acknowledge that there's getting ready to be a big one. And of course, everybody saw the massacre that happened in Paris. And once again, like I said, each week I kind of say it, but we're going to continue to see this rise, this terrorism rising. And what's interesting now is I'm starting to see another aspect come into play in terms of more of a dialogue of, should we take away free speech? You guys are going to see that played out more and more, what's considered hate speech. Is it hate speech to blaspheme the Prophet Muhammad? Is that hate speech? Will there soon be laws saying we can't criticize Islam? Will there soon be laws that we can't say Jesus is the only way to salvation? I think that stuff is what's coming down the pipeline. But with all those signs, all those crazy things happening in the last 2 weeks, there's one even greater super sign pointing to the fact that Jesus is returning, and that is the fact that there are violent sibling rivalries that are now skyrocketing. So let's check this out. I don't know what number that is, but that's like one of the top most watched videos of all time. But anyways, that's a for sure sign that Jesus is coming back, is sibling rivalries. So let's pray and get started.
Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time together. Thanks for getting everybody here safe this morning. We just ask that this morning, Father, that you open up our hearts and lives to your word this morning as Chuck teaches us more about Ephesus and the dangerous doctrines of Gnosticism. Help us learn, Lord, how this applies to us today. Help us learn what we can do to combat the hidden Gnosticism that surrounds us in the in this dangerous, I guess, philosophy and teaching. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray.
Amen. Anybody who missed last week, I highly... Yeah?
I'm surprised you didn't mention it, because I was thinking that you were going to mention the one... Okay, and on Facebook, I subscribe to Israel's News, and it says that they're now planning to build the temple.
Oh, yeah. We've mentioned that in the previous past. Yeah, they have everything. Temple Institute's ready to go. They've got every.
They're now getting ready to.
Yeah, they're even breeding specific cows for sacrifices. I mean, the third temple's ready to go. They're just waiting for the ability to be able to do it. With obviously with the discussion of whether the Dome of the Rock is where the Temple Mount should be, and until we get the whole Israel Islam. Deal settled. I don't know how it's going to work out. I think my leaning prophetically is I think there's going to be a major war before that happens. I think there's going to be something that goes down before they somehow they have to settle that Islam Israel quandrum.
Plus, there's a lot there's a researcher in archaeologist. His name is Bob Cornuke, and he thinks that he's discovered the site of the temple where the temple really was. Mm-hmm. It's actually downhill from the Temple of the Mount. So if you're looking at the Temple Mount and you see the Dome of the Rock, downhill from that would be the place where the temple used to be. Because Jesus said no stone will be left upon another, but you can see from this huge rectangular structure that there are stones still sitting on top of each other. And he's discovered that this is the same layout as every ancient Roman fort, that they think that Temple Mount site is really a Roman fort. It's not even the site of where the temple used to be. That if the Jews really wanted to build their temple, they could do it. They could do it right at the bottom of that hill because they own and control that piece of real estate. So I think as more research comes out, you know, and maybe in the future when the Jews realize, oh, wow, this is actual site. We actually control where we build our temple. Like, let's do this. But like Chuck said, it's more than likely going to be
I can see both of those. Yeah, I can see either one of those. So anyways, if you guys missed last week, I highly recommend going back and watching it because we covered a lot of Gnosticism. And the reason why we're covering Gnosticism is because Ephesus, this early, when the church first got planted, Gnosticism is the main philosophy, the main wrong teaching that crept into the church. So if we can learn from this wrong teaching early, we can kind of protect ourselves too. So just in review, I'm going to cover a few of the things we finished with last week. So the question is Gnosticism even relevant to today? We looked at the Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown, which actually is the number 10 best-selling book of all time, and it's sold over 80 million copies to date. So, and once again, what the Da Vinci Code does is it explores this idea that Jesus had a wife, and that wife was Mary Magdalene, which they get from Gnostic texts. So once again, it's very relevant in that term. National Geographic is constantly putting out material on these Gnostic Gospels. You see it advertised all the time. For instance, here the Judas Gospel, an ancient text lost for 1,700 years, says Christ's betrayer was his truest disciple. What I want to do is kind of, in review, read you this little article. So when you go to nationalgeographic.com, you can kind of dig a little deeper into some of their stories, and this is one of the stories that I found talking about Gnosticism from National Geographic. I'm just going to read it to you. The event at the center of Orthodox Christianity, Jesus' crucifixion, was radically reinterpreted by the Gnostics. Rather than a sacrificial death or atonement that frees believers from sin, the destruction of Jesus' body in the Gospel of Judas and other Gnostic texts frees his divine soul to rejoin God. But the Gnostics departed even further from Orthodox views of Jesus' suffering and death. Some of their writings say that although Jesus looked as though he inhabited a physical body, this was only an illusion. He was a divine being who could appear in many different forms, like that of a child in the Gospel of Judas. And also, if you guys have seen the new movie Moses, they portray the father as a child. Other Gnostic writings say that while a human being named Jesus did actually die, the divine part of him, or the Christ, did not. Instead, this divine part descended into Jesus at the baptism and departed his body just before Jesus' death on the cross, when he uttered the words, my God, why have you forsaken me? Still, other Gnostic writings say that someone else entirely, perhaps Simon of Cyrene, described as having briefly carried his cross, was put to death in place of Jesus, while he remained alive, laughing at the blindness of those who tried to kill him. So once again, you guys kind of see the blasphemy that these Gnostics did. What Satan's trying to do is he's trying to delude the cross. As long as Jesus died on the cross for our sins, so what he wants to do is throw illusions and falsities to the fact that Jesus, the fully human, fully God, died in our place on the cross. This one was really fascinating to me, what the Gnostic texts say about Cain and Abel. In the Old Testament, Cain kills his brother Abel and is cursed by God. But in Gnostic texts, Cain appears as a hero. Why celebrate a murderer? Because Gnostics saw the Old Testament God as a lower deity, that being the Father. They see the Father as being a lower deity. A power-crazed demiurge who created a flawed physical world that imprisons human souls. Salvation for them meant escaping the physical realm to be reunited with the true supreme being. To Gnostics, any defiance against the false creator God was an heroic act. So one school of Gnostics celebrated Cain's murder of Abel, whose offering of lambs the Old Testament God favored over Cain's offering of crops. In the same way, the same school celebrated the people of Sodom, the city that the Old Testament destroys after its people try to rape visiting angels. These Gnostics were not embracing murder or rape, they were identifying with those who rebelled against the Old Testament God. Isn't that interesting that I love that last sentence. The Gnostics were not embracing murder or rape. So they weren't embracing the murder or rape, but they were embracing the fact that we should rebel against this false creator of this known world. So once again, Satan is kind of seen as the good guy. He's the ultimate, he's the rebel, and we should all follow him because this evil creator kind of trapped us. We'll skip that one. The last one, kind of, the Gnostics, they have a hard time reconciling the mean, wrathful God of the Old Testament and the nice, loving Jesus, right? So what they do is they say that this Jesus actually came to free us from that mean Old Testament God. And they use crazy different things to spin that. But once again, just this is found on National Geographic's website. This is this kind of stuff that people are studying, and this is the kind of stuff that if you engage in conversation with people, they will bring this stuff to light, and they will say, what about this? What about these texts? So it's really important for us to kind of grasp them. And once again, we looked at the Gnostic Noah movie last week, or 2 weeks ago. This evil creator of the world wants to wipe out mankind, literally wipe humans from the earth, only because he wants to bring animals and plants. Like, he's seen as a super environmentalist. And Russell Crowe portrays Noah in the movie, who's a crazy killer himself. But the creator God tells Noah to slaughter his own daughter so that she can no longer breed and no longer create babies after they get off the ark. So once again, we see Noah as a crazy dude, but even he, in the end, doesn't fulfill what the creator wants. He says, no way, I can't do it. So even Noah, this crazy guy, is seen in more greater light than the creator of the universe. So once again, that's a Gnostic spin that people put in movies. And we see this, we could spend days and days, I've researched a lot of this. And by the way, if any of this stuff kind of interests you, like Hollywood, the Gnosticism in Hollywood, we have lots and lots of teachings on this.
I've got a DVD set that's 10 hours showing you Satanic Hollywood, how every single movie puts a satanic spin on everything. So if you're interested in that, let me know. And I've got Good Fight Ministries does an awesome job exposing the Satanism in Hollywood and in the music industry, if you're interested.
And not to say that watching these movies is necessarily a sin or, you know, wherever we stand on that, what I'm trying to say is, what is it doing to our kids? What is it doing? What are these movies teaching? We don't fully understand what watching things on a screen does to our brains. And over and over and over and over again, seeing these messages, for instance, in The Matrix and The Truman Show, where there's this creator of the universe who's seen as bad. What is that doing over and over again as we put this kind of stuff in our kids' brains? I mean, my brain, I already know it's gone. So I'm just kind of protecting my kids.
I'm just thinking, like, when you see these movies and you grow up with this subliminal message that the creator is bad, and then they get into college where every professor and, you know, secular institution is telling them that the creator doesn't even exist. It's real easy. You can see why people walk away from Christianity as soon as they become, you know, adolescents and adults, right into, you know, adulthood. And it's almost because we don't equip them with this information. We don't equip them with the knowledge they need to understand what the enemy that is fighting them, and how to defeat the enemy with truth, and what is truth, and how do we arrive at truth, and things of that nature. One of our favorite teachers, Frank Turek, says the reason these kids are being talked out of Christianity is that they were never talked into it in the first place. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's why we like to expose some of this stuff just a little bit, spend a little time on it.
My granddaughter just got through watching the movie God Is Not There, and she really liked the movie, but is that Gnostic?
I haven't actually seen it. I've heard really good things about it.
He does demonstrate some pretty solid apologetics, and they do say the name Jesus. They do use the name of Jesus. They, you know, it's not just God. There's, you know, it's not just God's not dead. They make it very clear that it is Jesus Christ. Mm. So I was happy to see that.
Yeah. So real quick, I want to fly through a Gnostic heresy list from the church fathers. So we know a majority of this Gnosticism from an early church father named Irenaeus. He wrote these letters refuting all these teachings that were trying to infiltrate the church at that time. They taught that there were 30 aeons, or gods. The goddess Sophia created the demiurge, which the demiurge is what we know as the father. Okay, they believe that Sophia, who the Greek word for wisdom, created the father. But Yahweh was just a creator angel who was a tyrant and believed he was the only god because he didn't know about the other gods. He created man, but Sophia gave man his spirit. They teach some can be saved by doing enough good works. Does that sound familiar? But some are predestined to hell. They believe that they have spirit emanations from Sophia that predestines them to be saved no matter what actions. So they literally believe that because they're predestined to be saved, they can do whatever they want. And in fact, some of the evil things that Gnostics do, they see that as purifying. They see they can find good in that. They believe that eventually all matter, so all physical matter, will be destroyed. Everything that's physical is bad because it was created from this evil creator, God. Gnostics will become spirits and will marry the angels. The Christ descended upon Jesus at baptism, but ascended before Pilate. Sophia would not allow the Christ to suffer. So once again, they're taking away the cross of Christ. They utter mantras to affect nature. Souls reincarnate, so that reincarnation's been taught. Sophia sent the serpent into the garden to free Adam and Eve. Gnosis saved them. So it's knowledge that saved Adam and Eve. And that Satan in the beginning was actually doing the good. Sophia saved Noah from the flood caused by evil Yahweh. At death, some souls enter an intermediate state to be purged of the animal evil nature before entering the Pleroma. So we see even there that purgatory, or a form of purgatory, was begun way before any Christianity got to it. So with that being said, I just made a note here. Notice that there's no battle with atheism. You know, we spend a lot of time nowadays battling with atheism. And I'm not going to say that it's not good to have an answer and a defense for atheism, but I'm kind of done beating that dead horse. You know, they didn't really have to, they didn't have to fight the is there really a God or not, which is kind of like the number one thing we have to fight today. And I think it's really important, but I'm spending more time on defending our faith in other ways. But just a hypothetical question: what would have happened had the Apostolic Church failed? And we know that couldn't happen because they were guided by the Holy Spirit. But once again, think about what these guys are under. Think about this constant bombardment of all these false doctrines that they're literally trying to infiltrate into the church. And once again, we know that it was the Holy Spirit, it was God the Father, it was Jesus, all keeping these doctrines, these texts that we have as the Bible, preserved for us. So, Gnosticism in the early church, you guys, if you want to write this down, there are some mentioned in the New Testament who fall for Gnostic heresy. Hymenaeus and Philetus are described in 2 Timothy 2, verse 17. Alexander the coppersmith in 2 Timothy 4, verses 14 through 15. Another church historian, Tertullian, recorded that Alexander joined the Ebionites, which the Ebionites were the group that believed that you had to do, that Jesus was just a good example, that man could be saved by following the law perfectly. The third group that was mentioned in the New Testament was a duo named Phygellus and Hermogenes, and they're in 2 Timothy 1, verse 15. And once again, Tertullian, the church historian, states that these two denied a physical resurrection of the body. So once again, Gnosticism teaches that matter, including our bodies, are bad. So they believe that all this is going to disappear and we eventually will just be spirit beings. Tertullian states that these men were who John was talking about in 1 John 2, verses 19. So let's check out 1 John 2:19. Little children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. So remember, these people were infiltrating the church. They were in the church. They were in congregations. And they tried to sneak these doctrines in. And eventually, they went off and created their own little Gnostic sects, S-E-C-T-S, by the way. But they would create their own little things. And notice here that he says they went out from us, but they were not of us. They were never truly born again. They didn't have the Holy Spirit living inside of them. They were off on their own tangent. But what I want to do is I want to take a second here and I want to show you something that I think makes this extremely important. Notice here in 1 John 2 that he says, it is the last hour. Okay? Check this out. You have heard that the Antichrist is coming. So the teaching was already in place that there's going to be this end time Antichrist coming into play, right? And he says, coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. So even in John's time, he saw this rise of Gnosticism, these Antichrists, these people denying the cross, denying Jesus coming in the flesh, is a sign that it's the end of the age, it's the end of time, it's the last hour. They knew that it was the last hour because there was a rise in these many antichrists. Okay, do you guys see that? So the question is, where did John get this teaching? Where did he get this understanding? And I personally believe that he got it from Jesus himself. Jesus has some super signs that he describes for the end of the age. In Matthew 24, verse 5, he says, "For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. Take heed that you not be deceived, for many will come in my name, saying, I am he." Now, I'm not going to go into explaining the chronology of Matthew 24 and Luke 21, but just needless to say, there's a strong possibility that I believe these verses that Jesus is alluding to here is kind of this false Gnostic gospel that we all can be Christ, that we all can be the Messiah, saying, I am the Messiah, I am Christ. Do you guys kind of see what I'm talking about there? That this is a sign that as this Gnosticism rises, that's a sign of the end times. It's a sign that Jesus is coming soon. So with that in mind, what I believe is in view there is that many Gnostics will come in Jesus' name. You can be like Jesus. You can have this Christ consciousness. You can evolve to this further level. This is kind of some of the terminology you guys are going to be hearing day in and day out.
Does this sound like familiar to you at all? Have you guys heard of this Christ consciousness? It's what Oprah teaches. Have you heard of the book or the DVD now, The Secret? That you can eat, like you can become godlike on your own through your good works, through speaking things into existence, through this, they call it a law of attraction, where you attract to yourself whatever you put out. So if you're putting out positivity and this Christ-like aura, that it's going to all come back to you, and you can basically ascend into a Christ-like existence on your own, that you don't need to cross, that's just one way. It's not the way. But that is dangerous, that is occultic, it is Gnosticism at its finest, and that's what these New Age teachers are teaching these days. That secret stuff is just straight dangerous.
And we'll cover more of that as we go. But I want you to notice, once again, if we truly believe that we're living in the age of Laodicea, which I do, there's a connection in the menorah with Laodicea and Ephesus. So as we continue to see this rise in Gnosticism, it's totally parallel to the same way that they saw in the church of Ephesus. One last point here to kind of really bring home why this Gnosticism is important to kind of have on our radar. I want to look at the Antichrist and his end time, quote, religion. So in Daniel 11, verses 36 through 39, we see this. Then the king, by the way, the king right there is the Antichrist. Okay, if you study the verse in context, it's the Antichrist. It's easy. The king shall do according to his own will. He shall exalt and magnify himself above every god, shall speak blasphemies against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the wrath has been accomplished. For what has been determined shall be done. So those first two things up there, he's going to magnify himself above every god. I believe that that's saying he's going to magnify himself above Jesus, above the prophet Muhammad, above Allah. Okay, all the known gods that we have today, he's going to magnify himself greater than those. And notice that he says there, Daniel being Jewish, a Jewish prophet, he says against the God of gods, and that's a capital G there. That's talking about Yahweh, the Father. He's going to say that he's even greater than the Father. Okay, let's go on here. He shall regard neither the God of his fathers nor the desire of women, nor regard any God, for he shall exalt himself above them all. So once again, just kind of re-emphasizing that. We'll break more of this down when we study the Antichrist. We're going to cover a lot with the Antichrist. But once again, he's not regarding any of the gods that we have in place today. So a lot of people think the Antichrist is going to be a Muslim, or he's going to propagate the Islamic faith across the world. I don't see that, especially from this text right here. And then check this out. This is where it gets really interesting. But in their place he shall honor a god of fortresses, and a god which his fathers did not know he shall honor with gold and silver. He shall honor a god of fortresses. This is one of the most confusing passages for people to really exegete, to break down. The Hebrew is really confusing, and it's very rarely used. He shall honor a god of forces would be the greatest translation. Thus he shall act against the strongest fortresses with a foreign god, which he shall acknowledge. So there's going to be a new god that this Antichrist is going to propagate. Okay, this is where things get real interesting. I personally believe the greatest explanation of who this god of forces is, or the god of fortresses, is actually Lucifer himself. I believe it's Satan. And I actually believe that the book of Revelation kind of hints at this or alludes to it. So my question for you guys to think about is, will this Antichrist, this guy who's going to step onto the world scene, will he be seen as the greatest manifestation of the Gnostic supreme deity? So remember, Gnostics believe that the Father is just another creator God, but they believe there's a supreme deity, the highest, the unknowable God that is just too good to be true. I believe somehow he will be claiming that he is a manifestation of that God. And then we see him here, he's paying homage to this foreign God. So some foreign God made him available to be able to be this super being. So who made this all possible? It goes all the way back to the garden, right? To the serpent freeing Adam and Eve, giving them knowledge. He's the one who made it possible for us to become like God, to become God, just as this Antichrist is going to be. And as I said, I believe Revelation alludes to this. In Revelation 13, and I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed. We'll talk a lot about that verse. There's a lot of different interpretations of that verse. We'll talk about it. I do believe the Antichrist is in view there. And all the world marveled and followed the beast. All the world follows this guy who's resurrected. And then notice that word right there. So they worship the dragon who gave authority to the beast. So this guy's getting his power and his authority from the dragon, the serpent. And then check this out. They worship the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him? Did you guys catch that? Now, they worship the dragon. So they're worshiping Lucifer, the serpent from the garden. And they worship the beast. So we see, once again, do you guys kind of see where I'm going with that? How this end-time Gnostic lie is going to elevate the dragon. The people are going to worship the dragon. They're going to worship Lucifer, a god that has never been known. And what's crazy is if you study secret societies and all these different things, one of the big secrets to secret societies is, once again,
just talking about Freemasonry.
All the above.
Things like that.
All the above. All these secret societies, they all go back to one of the big secrets, if not the biggest secret, is that Lucifer's the good guy. And just so you guys know, that goes all the way back to Mystery Babylon, and even further back into that, it goes further than we've ever known, or that we've ever understood, but that's the big secret. The big secret is Lucifer's the good guy, and he's the one who's going to save all mankind. That's the ultimate lie, and it's the same lie that happened in Genesis 3. So once again, my point in bringing all that out, as you study Gnosticism and all this end time stuff, can you guys understand why this early church was so dedicated to staying true to doctrine, to testing people, to testing doctrine? You guys can kind of see why that was super important. And as I study these guys, I'm so thankful. I thank God all the time that he preserved this stuff through all the garbage that was thrown at him. And we're still fighting it. But as kind of our concluding here, so once again, is this all historically prophetic? Did this church at Ephesus fulfill that church history that happened from AD 30 to AD 100? And we'll just kind of conclude looking at a kind of a review here. Once again, this was the church at Ephesus. I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars. They tested these Gnostics. They found they were liars. They got them out. They didn't associate with them, right? You have preserved and have patience and have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary. These guys were hardcore. They didn't mess around. They were extremely busy. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you've left your first love. So remember, these guys got so caught up in defending doctrine that they lost their first love. That's where we're going to have a big takeaway today. We don't want to lose our first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, also I will come quickly to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Nicolaitans, those were a Gnostic group, once again. So did they fulfill that historically? I believe so. So now, we're going to conclude today, and this is the most important part out of everything that we do. So when we're doing these seven letters, this is the most important part, okay? We learned all that stuff. We learned all that background information. We learned all that Gnosticism. So what can we do moving forward? What can we as believers in Christ do? This is the application. This is where the rubber meets the road. So personal devotion is our top priority, okay? Not doctrine. Devotion is our top priority. Being devoted to the one who saved us, the one who created us. Check out some of these verses. Deuteronomy 6. This in Hebrew is called the Shema. It's the most important prayer in Judaism. Okay, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Okay, that's the most important prayer to the Jews. Love God with everything you got. Jesus said it this way. He said, the first of all commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. This is the first commandment, and the second like it is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I studied this in depth a long time ago, and what's kind of interesting, did you guys know that scientists or secular scientists have discovered that there's what they call five compartments that make up humanity? There's five aspects that make humans what they are. And what's crazy is they all tie into this prayer right here. Check this out. You have one, so look at it in terms of health. We have emotional health, could be parallel our hearts. Spiritual health could parallel our soul. Mental health, our minds. Physical health, strength. Social, love your neighbor as yourself, so that outside source. You guys see that connection there? So what is Jesus saying? He's saying all these aspects that make us who we are, we have to love him with our emotions, we have to love him in our spirit, we have to love him with our mind, we have to love him with our physical body, everything we do. Every aspect of who we are is a stewardship. And socially, loving our neighbors as ourselves, that's stewardship. How do we treat others? So, kind of a cool little thing. And by the way, we can't do this on our own, guys. It's easy for me to grit my teeth and say, I'm going to love you more today, God. I'm going to do it. Watch, right? That, once again, we have to have through submission and prayer to the Holy Spirit. Look, Deuteronomy 30, verse 6, "And the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, that you may live." That circumcision of the heart, Paul talks about in Romans, that's after you've had that new birth. He's the one who makes us even able to love fully God. Once again, every aspect of our lives that we give over to God is only done in submission to him. One last little crazy one. This is kind of one of my life verses, Hebrews 13:5, and I never fully grasped it until I really studied Ephesus here. "Let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have, for he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you." That never really sunk in. But what it's saying is, it doesn't matter what we have. We don't need to be covetous of anything because we have Jesus. We have everything we need, right? That really didn't sink in until recently. So our first takeaway, personal devotion is our top priority. Number two, we must remember who is in control. Remember the picture all the way back at the very beginning of Jesus holding these seven churches in his hand. He's the one who's in control. He's the one who's guiding us. He's the one who wants our devotion. He's in control. We got to always remember that. We must understand imminency in evangelism. So with that being said, Pastor Block talks about this all the time. Jesus is coming soon. That should make us excited to tell people the good news. That should make us excited to tell people about the gospel. These guys believed that the end was, I mean, we just saw in 1 John that they saw these Gnostic dudes as a sign that it's about to go down. It's about over. And they used that to go get the message out even further. Okay? We should be able to test and discern. These guys were super good at testing. And they used doctrine. They used songs. They used different things to ensure that they were testing from these outside sources. You guys, whether you know it or not, you're going to be bombarded from outside sources, whether it's Gnosticism, whether it's humanism, whether all these isms are going to be bombarding you, and you need to be able to test and discern what your Bible says and have an answer to these. We must do that. We must understand the false paradigm of clergy laity. This has to do with the Nicolaitans. Once again, the Nicolaitans was that group that they believed that there was this separate godly caste system where it was the godly uppers who controlled these lower, we're just low-level laity, okay? What's amazing is if we're not careful, we can even do that here just through the motions. You guys may think, oh, Pastor Block and Brandon, they're the super spiritual guys. They're the ones who are going to pray. They're the ones who are going to do this and this and this, fill in the blank. Chuck and T. Hood, they're the nerds. They're the ones who are supposed to be studying their Bible, not me, right? That right there, even in your mindset, is wrong. This is all of us. We all got to do this. And one of the things that kind of drives me crazy is a lot of Christians, when I'm talking to them at the smoothie shop or wherever, they think that church is going to a building on a Sunday afternoon. Oh, I walk through these doors, and now all of a sudden I'm super spiritual, right? Whether you understand it or not, what you're doing is you're creating a false paradigm in your mind. Church is an overflow of what we do all week. All 7 days we're doing this and this and this. And then all Sundays we come together and we multiply that, okay? So get the thought out of your mind that I have to be somebody different at church, or if I do this thing one day a week, I'm being a super spiritual guy. What you're doing is you're creating that false paradigm in your mind.
Yeah, and if you're super spiritual on one day of the week, then the rest of the days of the week you're actually becoming almost in a sense a lukewarm Christian, where you're, if you don't take the application from that one day, if you're not applying it every day, if you're not devoting everything you have to the Lord, you're breaking the first commandment. And I'm just as guilty as anybody. I have to find my times in the middle of the week, and I feel I'm bogged down by the world, and I have to remember, okay, Jesus washed the apostles' feet. I need to get back in the Word. I need a spiritual boost. I can tell when my spirit is down, you know, and that's why we have to follow that first commandment that he was talking about, the love of the Lord God with all that you are, everything that you have. If you just refocus back on Jesus, that will give you that spiritual boost that will keep you on fire.
Amen.
What was that first scripture, Deuteronomy, under personal devotion?
The Shema?
Yeah.
What?
6:4-5. Okay. We must continue to cultivate relationship. For instance, me and my wife, we dropped our grandkids off with Melanie, and we had a date night that last Friday night, which we haven't done in a while. We need to do more. But just using that as an example, we have to find ways to cultivate relationship. Relationship just doesn't happen, does it? I don't know about you guys. Any of you guys that are married, if you just continue to kind of go through the same motions over and over again, and your relationship grows stale, right? We have to find new ways to cultivate that relationship. Same thing spiritually. Whether it's I try to find a new, but we got to be careful, but whether I try to find a new way to read through the Bible, or whether I try to find a new way to pray, or whether I try to find a new way to whatever, it's finding different ways to cultivate a better relationship with God. We must acknowledge that we may be called to repent. Guys, 5 out of these first 7 churches are going to be told to repent. I'm not sitting up here saying that I'm perfect. Every one of these churches that I've studied, I've repented over certain things because I was like, wow, that's me. Wow, I'm Ephesus. Wow, I'm Pergamos. Wow, I'm Laodicea. All those things. And I'm having to repent and through the Holy Spirit change my mind and be different. We must understand legalism and empty religion. Once again, this is what, if we're not careful and we focus only on doctrine and we focus only on being super spiritual and we focus only on knowing our Bible and we focus on only knowing fill in the blank, we're going to lose sight of Jesus, and we're going to become empty legalists, and we're going to have empty religion, where all we're doing is we're going into church, and we're checking in, and we're checking that checkbox off the week, and then we go about our weeks just like nothing ever happened. Finally, last one, we must understand Gnosticism and possible end times delusions. That was kind of what we covered today. We got to have this stuff on our radar. We have to have key words on our radar, like Christ consciousness.
Law of attraction.
And really be paying attention to movies. You know, what are we putting in our kids' brains? What are we putting in our kids' faces? Like I said, my brain's mush. It's toast. So I'm not really worried about me. But my kids, I'm definitely worried about. So those are kind of our key takeaways. We'll conclude. Next week, we're going to actually start Smyrna. So there you have it. We got through one church, and it only took shade under a decade. So at this rate, we'll be done with the churches in about 8 months. Let's pray and get out of here. Father, we thank you for this time. God, we thank you that you preserved your word once again. It's miraculous. God, I just pray that you would pour your Holy Spirit out on each and every one of us in here. God, that we would be able to love you with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, with all of our strength, and we would be able to love others just as you have, God. That's a supernatural love. It's a supernatural devotion that you can only give us. We can't do it on our own, God. I thank you. I do pray, God, that we're able to discern all this information and all these different things that come at us. We need to be able to discern the good from the bad, to filter that out. God, I pray for supernatural spiritual discernment in this group. God, we thank you, we praise you, and we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.